undercover. They not only looked like part of the family, they behaved like them too. Armed with the latest camera technology, they were taken across the globe to understand the true nature of the animals they met and reveal how intelligent they really are, how badly behaved they can be, how important family is to them, and if it's possible that they can truly love each other. What they discovered may change our perception of animals forever. Could animals be more like us than we ever believed possible? To answer the questions at the heart of this series required an innovative and unconventional approach. So how did the spy creatures do it? The series took 3 years to make, and each trip deployed a rather unique filming team. Spy Orang is just one of 34 spy creatures that infiltrated the lives of over 30 different animal families across the world. These lifelike robots are designed to capture intimate images from inside the family. To create them stretches technology to the limit, and deploying them is just as challenging. Spy Orang is at the pinnacle of their spying game, but it started with humble beginnings almost 16 years ago. This is BoulderCam, a camera disguised as a moving rock to get a fresh perspective on life in a pride. It was designed to withstand a lion attack, but the reaction from the cubs was curiosity. And their mother was equally relaxed. BoulderCam simply became part of the landscape. And the footage revealed lion families in a totally new light. Capturing such unguarded and intimate views is still at the heart of what the spy creatures are designed to achieve. The new generation are lifelike replicas programmed to communicate with the animals they meet. Producer Philip Dalton prepares Spy Wild Dog Pup for his first deployment. Before the pack returns to the den, he tests that the 24 moving parts are all working. Spy Pup's body language is key to the success of his assignment. First encounters are a nerve-wracking moment. Even pups could rip him to pieces. But Spy Pup gives only friendly reactions. And it works a treat. It's a huge relief. There was a lot at stake. Spy Pup is the result of a huge amount of work in a small London studio. Beneath the skin is a miracle of animatronic engineering. A skeleton of articulated metal limbs controlled by sophisticated electronics and servos. The moves of the different creatures' real-life counterparts are programmed and tested. Each one takes months to design and build. The Meerkat is the first spy to be created for the series. John Nolan is its genius creator. He's worked on many top Hollywood films, and here he works closely with the production team to ensure all the animals' movements are as lifelike as possible. The final proof will be on location. Meerkats aren't keen on outsiders, so this first assignment is a tough one. To make sure she smells right, she's been anointed with poo from the colony. After a thorough investigation, the meerkats are convinced enough to allow her into the family. so she can capture remarkable footage of their complex lives. But the more remote the location, the more important it is that the spy creatures are accepted. Having hitched a ride to the Antarctic, if Spyadeli isn't accepted, it will be a very long and wasted journey. But a previous spy series filmed by Penguin Cams means that his technology is tried and tested. He's on board a French supply ship on its way to their Antarctic base. After a week-long journey from Australia, the ship finally arrives at the aptly named Adeliland, and his subjects are there to greet him. Of course, he needs help. Even the most sophisticated spy cameras need human support. Putting up with the freezing conditions is Frédéric Olivier, an Antarctic scientist turned cinematographer. But there's no time to acclimatise. Real Adelies are returning to their nests, and filming must start immediately. Spy Adelie gets his first taste of what he's dealing with. As the Adelies head for the colony, Frédéric and Spy Adelie follow. Frédéric is used to this kind of work. She's been to the Antarctic 16 times, and for the last spy film spent nearly a year here. The colony lies 2 miles across the frozen sea ice, not far from the French base. Since Penguin Cam's last film here, scientists have been using them to gather important data inside the colonies. The penguins so accept the spies, they continue with their natural behaviour. Penguin cams aren't just liked by penguins. They become welcome company for someone working alone for long periods.
What do you reckon?
And Frédéric has formed a strong bond with Spy Adelie.
Excuse moi. Bon, this is going to fail. We're going to go to the colony. We're going to go to the colony. And we're going to talk to your mates. All right? Up. All right, mate. I take you control with me.
As these penguins aren't fazed by humans, she can deploy on foot. But she must still be careful. She must never put them off their nests. And they won't behave naturally while she's near. When she moves away, things return to normal. Because penguin cams don't interfere with natural behaviour, they've become a useful device not only for filming, but for scientific research too. Spy Adelie came for 2 months to film the penguins stealing stones to build their nests. But he discovered so much more. When a male has his pebbles stolen and fails to impress his mate, she runs off with his love rival. And feathers fly. But perhaps his most useful skill for filming Adelies is his ability to get right back up. Again, and again. When all else fails, Frédéric is there to lend a caring hand. But this wasn't the only elemental challenge the spies faced. In Kachemak Bay in Alaska, rafts of sea otters regularly congregate just offshore. They are notoriously nervous of people, especially when they have young babies on board. The only way to capture images like this is to create a spy creature that can swim right up to them. The challenge is to somehow create a lifelike replica of one of the most adorable animals on Earth. Back at John Nolan's studio, the basic mechanics are fiendishly complex, but they are just the start. It's Val Jones's job to turn a mechanical and functional robot into something closer to the real thing. This requires meticulously punching synthetic fur into the silicon skin, hair by hair. It takes incredible patience and an artistic eye to get a spy otter to look as lifelike as possible. It's this attention to detail that makes it really come alive. It will be many weeks before it's ready to be deployed among the sea otters of Alaska. But when the day comes, there are no guarantees it will work. Producer Matthew Gordon and the film crew are about to see whether the hard work has been worth it. A stabilised camera system is also ready to film the otters from afar.
Go zoom in. That's it. Work with it. That'll be a nice move then.
The images hint at what delightful subjects the otters are going to make.
It was the way he was doing his hands like this, okay?
What are you doing?
He's even doing it now. Look, it's wonderful.
Resting his head on his hands.
Yeah.
Just watching.
It's adorable.
Check's over. It's time to see if Spy Otter can get the intimate footage it came for. As otters are so difficult to approach, the boat must stay a long distance away.
Okay, let's try and get over there.
The colony doesn't seem to be alarmed as Spy Otter swims closer.
Are they reacting to it?
They sort of pop their head up and they look at it, but they're not scared.
But as Spy Otter moves further from the boat, the controls stop responding. It has reached the limits of good radio reception. Time for a rethink. This time they try a rib. Its lower profile may allow it to get closer to the otters so they can effectively control Spy Otter. Even now it's uncertain whether the spy creature will be accepted.
Okay, you guys feel free to deploy him when you want, and then you need to pull out.
But it's looking more promising. They are already nearer to an otter than before.
Oh, brilliant.
And Spy Otter boldly swims ever closer.
Okay. Get the head into the right position so they can film it, doesn't it? Magnificent. Yes. Love it.
This is what they've come to film. Some of the most natural and endearing shots of sea otters ever seen. Spy Otter can even film what's happening underwater. Gets a close-up view of their intelligent use of tools. Exactly what the team were hoping to capture. With another success under the team's belt, back in London, more spy creatures are being prepared for their first encounters. Like the sea otter, Spy Prairie Dog is one of many creations made to replicate the animals they are going to film. But sometimes, a different solution is needed. This is Spy Egret. He too is as lifelike as possible. And under the feathers and skin, the metal skeleton is no less impressive. But he's not going to film other birds. His sights are set much higher. He is soon on his first assignment. It's not long before he catches a glimpse of his subjects. Egrets like him follow the elephant herds around, but he's not the only lifelike camera going undercover. Michael Richards is one of the world's most experienced wildlife cameramen and has filmed elephants many times before. He must anticipate the elephant's intentions and deploy remote cameras on a track he thinks they'll take. First out are the plop cams, based on a ball of elephant poo. Then it's the log cams. And finally, a spy tortoise. Now it's spy egret's turn, the most expensive, fragile and irreplaceable of the lot. It's time for quick decisions.
I think they're turning according to us.
Well, they are.
Yeah. It's just popping down here.
Right, okay, swing it. Keep coming. And then you're going to have to reverse. Just so I can hide behind the vehicle. That's great. Thank you. Stop there. Stop up. Just so they can't see me.
Probably exactly as you want.
Okay.
The plan is for him to film at the same height as baby elephants, from right inside the herd. With the crew controlling him from a distance, he now has to face the elephants on his own. It's a nerve-wracking moment as he disappears inside a wall of legs. Thanks to some very obliging elephants, the egret survives unscathed. In fact, over the 10 weeks spent with the herd, hardly a feather was ruffled. The same cannot be said for some of the log cams and dung cams. Cameras, you might think, would be less noticeable. Perhaps they simply appealed to the elephant's playful nature. The spy tortoises fared better, probably because they looked like a living animal. Although there is always one that goes a step too far. Testing one of the spy tortoises to destruction. But the spies are resilient creatures. Even when thoroughly pancaked, his cameras kept filming. Hiding in plain sight proved the best plan. All he ever got was mud in his eye. Spy egret may have survived, but because of the dangerous nature of their subjects, others were in mortal danger from the start. Spy crocodile hatchlings were at the sharp end of one of the most deadly animals of them all. They have to be placed in the croc's nest in the brief period she's in the water. Something not for the faint-hearted. They are here to film the crocodile's remarkable maternal instincts. She places her hatchlings in her mouth to carry them to water as a protection against nest-raiding predators. It's not long before Spy Hatchling receives the same extraordinary treatment. and captures a baby croc's view from inside the jaws. It took 8 weeks and 3 trips to the Nile River in Uganda to film the 2 crocodile sequences seen in the series. Here, the team also tested the most ambitious walking spy creature to date. Spy Crocodile has come all the way from a biorobotics lab in Lausanne, Switzerland, where it took 6 months to build. The team, led by producer Rob Pelly, has to find a safe spot to launch the robot near to real crocodiles. But it's a wild and dangerous place. Surrounded by animals that can kill you. The river itself can be treacherous.
It's nice and shallow, it's like the crocs love it as well, it's perfect. It'll run aground at any minute. Ducks.
With hidden sandbanks in the shadows. That was one of them. When they find a sheltered spot, they don't waste any time. Scientists from the lab, Camilo Melo and Tomislav Horvat, are eager to test out their creation. Spy Crocodile is unique, as it is designed to be the first amphibious robot, able to walk on the ground and swim in the water.
You can make him stand up, please, chaps. That's great.
First tests are on land, but it still requires a radio transmitter and wrist computer to control. Walking seems okay, so it's time to see if all the hard work has paid off.
Walking and a bit more, and swimming.
He's off to a good start, moving with the sinuous motion of a real crocodile. But there's a problem. He's sinking.
I think what's happened is he's got lots of...
Yeah.
It's had a walk.
What?
It's had a walk and a walk.
It's a huge setback for Bob and the team. The inner skin is letting in water.
What do you want to do? Do you want to...
Just cool it down.
Yeah. OK.
This one.
Got any problems?
Yeah.
Wait, I can turn it off maybe. What is it?
They must try it out and hope for the best.
Is that select?
Fortunately, the complex electronics still seem to be working.
Let's make some crap.
Then it's doing weird.
His metal skeleton is based on that of a real crocodile, and all the movements need to be tested again. Even undressed, he still moves uncannily like the real thing. Everything seems to be in order. Now they have to make sure the skin stays waterproof this time. He looks as good as new. But how will he fare in the water? It seems a successful repair. Now there are real crocs to find. Back at the crocodile nests, the spy hatchlings are taking a pounding. Crocs crack open their own half-hatched eggs to free the babies before taking them to water. The spy hatchlings don't fare as well as the real things. Although 6 were destroyed while filming, it was all worth it. In the rainforest of Eastern Australia, the spy cameras were to face unexpected dangers of a very different nature. These are juvenile bowerbirds, nature's kleptomaniacs. And this is Spy Bowerbird, mimicking an adult in his bower. He's here to film the real bird's fascination with blue objects, and how they use them to attract females to their dancing grounds. What the filming reveals is that gangs of juveniles also love to steal. The blue jewels are irresistible. Some contain cameras. Caught red-handed, they arrange the loot in their own bower some distance away. Here, they hone the dancing skills that will ultimately help them attract a mate. But their bower is soon attracting other interest. Children out to feed the birds. They are unaware that many of the jewels contain cameras. How could any child resist?
Dad, look at this.
You just did all that down there, did you?
Yep. Should we keep it?
No, this is going to stay here.
Then the penny drops.
Oh my God. Dad, look at this. They're cameras.
Yeah.
Why did they put it there when Peter or someone's going to steal it? I don't know, because that's the owlbear's nest. Shall I show Mum these two cameras?
No, it's got to stay here, mate. It's here for a reason.
Mum! I'm going to take this!
The kids return their precious finds to the bower. It's no problem for the juveniles. They're used to having their treasures stolen by other thieving bower birds. Once calm is restored, they simply tidy up and carry on practicing dancing. Wherever the spy cameras went, they faced different challenges. But placing spy cameras among one of the most intelligent animals on Earth was one of the greatest. It also promised to be one of the most revealing. A spy tortoise creates an extraordinary reaction when one young chimp takes it to his heart. It stirs up possessive feelings. A desire to own and cherish. But sometimes it's the simplest spy cameras that provide the biggest surprises. This young chimp has found a camera disguised as a forest fruit. It accidentally captures an intimate view of some other chimp's bath time. But it's another spy creature that steals the show. Spy Bush Baby is testing the chimpanzee's reactions to something they would normally hunt. The crew track the chimpanzees for miles every day, from dawn to dusk, so as not to lose them in the vast forest. As soon as they hear their cries, they don face masks, as chimps must be protected from human diseases. The masks make the hot, humid journey even more arduous. And the sweat bees don't improve conditions either.
Oh, that's good right, my dear. Got a lovely sweat bees. Oh, my God.
What a serious amount of CWOs, God.
To deploy Spy Bush Baby without the chimp seeing them requires the help of an expert.
So this is our Spy Bush Baby duo.
Jill Preets is one of the world's leading biological anthropologists, and she's been studying these chimps for over 15 years. She knows their behaviour better than anyone. Producer Matt trained as a primatologist. Partnerships with scientists like Jill are what made the series possible.
I think in the first instance, when the
Jim's coming, we'll have him already up.
Yeah.
And not have him moving or anything like that, just to see if he reacts, if they notice anything.
Right.
And then do some space.
Bush babies are the chimps' favourite food. How they react could provide new insights into their human-like behaviour.
Hello, bush baby. We're going to put you now with the chimps.
Yeah. It needs Jill's help to predict where the chimps will pass. They can hear the chimps are on their way, so deployment must be quick. But first, he needs to be carefully secured in place.
One, two, three.
Checks over, and Spy Bush Baby is on his own. Matt and Jill can hear the chimps approaching. But it's Spy Bush Baby that captures the first tantalizing view. These are supremely intelligent animals. They think carefully about anything new. He knows that this bush baby is out of the ordinary. While some show interest, others just get on with their lives. But the spy creatures always reveal surprising behaviour. And a male that has been studying him does something quite unexpected. Aware the female is watching, his whole attitude changes. He now starts to show off. It's a human-like trait that is exactly the kind of behaviour the series set out to reveal. It was once frowned upon to make comparisons between human and animal behaviour, but scientists and filmmakers who study animals in the wild frequently observe extraordinary similarities. The male really seems to be trying to make an impression on the watching female, and her lack of interest seems a blow to his ego. His look says it all. In the heat of the day, the similarities between the two species are difficult to ignore. In a quest to explore our animal connections, the crew travel to the ends of the earth. Few places are more remote than the Arctic wilderness of Ellesmere Island in northern Canada. Their camp is set in 70,000 miles of uninhabited tundra, and a key team member is ready for action. Spy Wolf Cub is part of an expedition to find the elusive Arctic wolf. But round here, the wolves come looking for you. Ellesmere wolves live in isolation and rarely encounter people. Their innate curiosity and lack of fear draws them to the camp. This young wolf shows no aggression. He's more interested in the new smells. It's a perfect opportunity to get the wolves used to the spy cub and the crew. For wolf biologist Kira Cassidy, getting this close to Arctic wolves is a rare treat. Wolves aren't encouraged to visit the camp, but there's little anyone can do about it. Here, they make the rules. Specialist camera operator Hugh Williams tries not to put a foot wrong. Exploring anything new is in their nature. But once they've given the camp a thorough going over, they head off back to the den. Kira keeps a watchful eye on them. The den is located about a kilometre from the camp. Producer cameraman Philip Dalton sets his camera up as near as he can without disturbing their natural behaviour. After they feed, the adults head off hunting and the cubs disappear into the den. This is the moment the crew have been waiting for. Spy creatures are always deployed when the animals aren't watching. To avoid them being associated with people, it's important they aren't seen being put down. The crew head out in the direction of the den. Hugh deploys Spy Cub near to the den's entrance. He tests the remote controls before moving a safe distance away. Then a range check for the video link. It's not long before the cubs emerge. Over the next few weeks, Spy Cub and the crew capture some of the most intimate moments of Arctic wolf life ever filmed. He is totally accepted by the cubs, although he's not programmed to roll over and play like the real cubs do. Perhaps that's one for the next generation of spy creatures. When spies are deployed, the encounters are covered on a long lens some distance away, but suddenly Philip notices the wolves have returned and seem to be playing tug of war. They've stolen his jacket. To find out where they've taken it, he uses a drone. The wolves are so engrossed in their game, they don't even notice the aerial surveillance. Then they roll on the coat. It's their way of leaving their mark before abandoning it. Later, time to assess the damage.
Considering it was set upon by a pack of wolves.
Is that urine?
Who?
Oh.
It isn't only personal belongings that the wolves roughhandle. Spy Cub may have been popular with most of the wolves, but he didn't survive unscathed. His camera eye tells the story. He has been carried by the scruff of his neck, just like she would carry one of her own cubs. This journey is the last thing he ever filmed. When filming dangerous animals, it helps to have spy creatures in reserve. In Kenya, spy hippo is about to swim among the real thing. He is one of two different models that are being deployed. Park regulations mean the crew have to be accompanied by an armed ranger. It is Rosie's job to protect against poachers. And of course, the river's inhabitants can be dangerous as well. This spy hippo is submersible and is mainly designed to film underwater shots of the hippos. A second spy hippo has been constructed to film mainly at the surface.
Tom, can you get on the sticks, please?
Both spy creatures offer close-up views above and below the water. A successful launch, and the submersible spy hippo is soon entering their world. And he's soon getting some promising footage. Now it's the other spy hippo's turn to see what he can capture. A tantalizing glimpse. But can he get closer? Before long, they're face to face. Then, some of the closest views of hippos ever captured. But despite spy creatures having eyes everywhere, they can still be caught unawares. Close for comfort. Then, a huge problem. Spy hippo's motors are stuck in the weed. Producer Rob faces an unenviable decision. The waters may be full of hippos, but with few alternatives, he decides to launch a one-man rescue mission. There are crocs in these waters too, but if he moves too quickly, it could attract them. Rosie and the crew scan the clear water carefully. It's a calculated risk. Rob knows that hippos rarely attack in water. But he must still watch his step. He's a zoologist with over 20 years' experience of wildlife filmmaking. But it's still a tense moment. It's a huge relief when both he and Spy Hippo make it to the bank. However many precautions you take, filming dangerous animals always carries a risk. Another crew are in Botswana, trying to track down the wild dogs. Cameraman Richard Jones has spent his professional life filming African animals, and he can read their every sign.
There's a doggy footprint there.
His instincts are rarely wrong.
Are they fresh?
No, that's this morning.
In this terrain, animals are extremely difficult to find.
I can see the plains ahead.
But the fresh trail soon leads him to the pack. The dogs seem to have found something concealed in the long grass. A male leopard.
He's coming this way.
Richard senses trouble. He makes a bizarre request.
Where's my hat?
Why he wants his hat becomes clear as things escalate. He knows the dogs are deliberately winding up the leopard. They are far too nimble to be caught, and the angry leopard takes refuge in a tree. With their enemy humiliated, the wild dogs slink away. But the leopard is left pumped up with aggression. He shifts focus to the crew, stuck in the back of the truck.
That was directed at us, isn't it?
Richard explains about the hat.
It must be ready to throw it at the leopard.
Will that work?
I'm not quite sure.
No one can reach the driver's seat. They are totally exposed. Then it happens. The leopard jumps onto the vehicle to grab Richard.
Hey, guy! Why?
He was going for us.
What we didn't see is Richard throwing his hat.
Your hat worked.
Yeah.
Well, should we get moving in case he decides to come back and have some more of us?
He knew it was his best chance to distract the leopard. Richard's experience and quick thinking saves the day. Fortunately, the wild dog pup and other spy creatures usually enjoy a far warmer welcome. Spy Langa is no exception. Under the skin is a tiny plastic skull with sophisticated electronics and a 4K camera packed in. But it's what's happening in the living brain of the real monkeys that Spy Langa is built to film. He's deployed at an Indian temple to record their babysitting skills. First reactions are always fascinating. But the important work begins when the spies are fully embedded among the animals they are filming. This shoot lasts a month, and over time, the monkeys become totally used to spy monkey. But some things can never be predicted. When spy monkey is removed from his perch and drops, they appear to believe he has died. They react just as they do when a real baby dies. The show of grief is not only moving, it also astonishes the scientist here who has studied the langurs for the last 10 years. It provides new insights into the mind of a sophisticated and caring primate. Generally, the more intelligent the animal, the more sophisticated the spy creature needs to be. And the greatest challenge is yet to come. Design on the creature starts with computer modelling, and this one is the most ambitious yet. A spy orangutan with the facial expressions of the real thing. The head alone has over 30 moving parts. After months of work, the finished spy orang is in Borneo, ready to see if the hard work had been worth it. But first, she has to pass the scrutiny of the most revered orangutan scientist in the world. To maintain the surprise, she is concealed from view.
It's a real pleasure to introduce our spy orangutan to you.
Oh my gosh, what a... She's truly a beauty. Let me take a picture of her.
Feel free to go and have a closer look at all the details, that's it.
Oh, beautiful.
This is Dr. Biruti Guldikas. She has spent the last 40 years studying and conserving orangutans. Matt shows her how this spy creature works.
It's got quite a wide field of view as well.
But she's not the only one keen to take a look.
And the wild orangutan is mesmerised. She's over there.
Orangutans are highly intelligent and hard to fool.
But now she's stupefied.
What always fascinates us is knowing what must be going through their mind.
Well, they're trying to figure out if she's feeling.
Right.
From this distance, she looks very real.
Yeah.
You can tell what they're thinking just from the eyes.
Yeah.
Now, her expressions are very good.
Yeah.
Very good.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah. Now, she's very real. Well, maybe we should move.
Yeah.
So that the orangutans can come by. And let's see what happens.
These initial reactions are always unpredictable. It's not long before a curious male is displaying his intelligence. Why not use a branch to test Spy Rang's reaction? It's just one of many encounters in the time she spent among them. This youngster is especially curious. It even takes a clump of hair. Perfect for trying out a new look. But it takes 2 weeks for the crew to get the footage they hardly dared hope for. Suddenly, from out of the jungle, one of Dr. Biruti's favourite orangutans appears and picks up a saw left at a research hut.
Wow, Cicely, wow!
When she sees that Spy Orang is sawing too, it becomes a competition. in the end, she tires of the game and takes a more laid-back approach. With the help of the spy-orang, this female, born and raised in the wild, gives us a glimpse of just how small the gap between us really is. Having astounded us with what she could do, she heads back to the jungle. Congregate just offshore. They are notoriously nervous of people, especially when they have young babies on board. The only way to capture images like this is to create a spy creature that can swim right up to them. The challenge is to somehow create a lifelike replica of one of the most adorable animals on Earth. Back at John Nolan's studio, the basic mechanics are fiendishly complex, but they are just the start. It's Val Jones's job to turn a mechanical and functional robot into something closer to the real thing. This requires meticulously punching synthetic fur into the silicon skin, hair by hair. It takes incredible patience and an artistic eye to get a spy otter to look as lifelike as possible. In the rainforest of Eastern Australia, the spy cameras were to face unexpected dangers of a very different nature. These are juvenile bowerbirds, nature's kleptomaniacs. And this is Spy Bowerbird, mimicking an adult in his bower. He's here to film the real bird's fascination with blue objects and how they use them to attract females to their dancing grounds. What the filming reveals is that gangs of juveniles also love to steal. The blue jewels are irresistible. But some contain cameras. Caught. It seems a successful repair. Now there are real crocs to find. Back at the crocodile nests, the spy hatchlings are taking a pounding. Crocs crack open their own half-hatched eggs to free the babies before taking them to water. The spy hatchlings don't fare as well as the real things. Although six were destroyed while filming, it was all worth it. In the rainforest of Eastern Australia, the spy cameras were to face unexpected dangers of a very different nature. These are juvenile bowerbirds, nature's kleptomaniacs. And this is Spy Bowerbird, mimicking an adult. After a week-long journey from Australia, the ship finally arrives at the aptly named Adelieland, and his subjects are there to greet him. Of course, he needs help. Even the most sophisticated spy cameras need human support. Putting up with the freezing conditions is Frédéric Olivier, an Antarctic scientist turned cinematographer. But there's no time to acclimatise. Real Adelies are returning to their nests, and filming must start immediately. Spy Adelie gets his first taste of what he's dealing with. As the Adelies head for the colony, Frédéric and Spy Adelie follow. Frédéric is used to this kind of work. Perhaps they simply appeal to the elephant's playful nature. spy tortoises fared better, probably because they looked like a living animal. Although there is always one that goes a step too far. Testing one of the spy tortoises to destruction. But the spies are resilient creatures. Even when thoroughly pancaked, his cameras kept filming. Then, some of the closest views of hippos ever captured. But despite spy creatures having eyes everywhere, they can still be caught unawares. A little too close for comfort. Then, a huge problem. Spy hippo's motors are stuck in the weed. Producer Rob faces an unenviable decision. The waters may be full of hippos, but with few alternatives, he decides to launch a one-man rescue mission. There are crocs in these waters too, but if he moves too quickly, it could attract them. Rosie and the crew scan the clear water carefully. It's a calculated risk. Rob knows that hippos rarely attack in water. But once they've given the camp a thorough going over, they head off back to the den. Kira keeps a watchful eye on them. The den is located about a kilometre from the camp. Producer cameraman Philip Dalton sets his camera up as near as he can without disturbing their natural behaviour. After they feed, the adults head off hunting and the cubs disappear into the den. This is the moment the crew have been waiting for. Spy creatures are always deployed when the animals aren't watching. To avoid them being associated with people, it's important they aren't seen being put down. The crew head out in the direction of the den. To swim among the real thing. He is one of two different models that are being deployed. Park regulations mean the crew have to be accompanied by an armed ranger. It is Rosie's job to protect against poachers. And of course, the river's inhabitants can be dangerous as well. This spy hippo is submersible and is mainly designed to film underwater shots of the hippos. A second spy hippo has been constructed to film mainly at the surface.
Tom, can you get on the sticks, please?
Both spy creatures offer close-up view. They are already nearer to an otter than before. And spy otter boldly swims ever closer.
Okay. Get the head into the right position so they can film it in the yes. Love it.
This is what they've come to film. Some of the most natural and endearing shots of sea otters ever seen. Spy otter can even film what's happening underwater. Before the pack returns to the den, he tests that the 24 moving parts are all working. Spy pup's body language is key to the success of his assignment. First encounters are a nerve-wracking moment. Even pups could rip him to pieces. But Spy Pup gives only friendly reactions. And it works a treat. It's a huge relief. There was a lot at stake. Spy Pup is the result of a huge amount of work in a small London studio. Beneath the skin is a miracle of animatronic engineering. A skeleton of articulated metal limbs controlled by sophisticated electronics and servos. The moves of the different creatures' real-life counterparts are programmed and test animals. They think carefully about anything new. He knows that this bush baby is out of the ordinary. While some show interest, others just get on with their lives. But the spy creatures always reveal surprising behaviour. And a male that has been studying him does something quite unexpected. Aware the female is watching, his whole attitude changes. He now starts to show off. It's a human-like trait that is exactly the kind of behaviour the series set out to reveal. It was once frowned upon to make the only way to capture images like this is to create a spy creature that can swim right up to them. The challenge is to somehow create a lifelike replica of one of the most adorable animals on Earth. Back at John Nolan's studio, the basic mechanics are fiendishly complex, but they are just the start. It's Val Jones' job to turn a mechanical and functional robot into something closer to the real thing. This requires meticulously punching synthetic fur into the silicon skin, hair by hair. It takes incredible patience and an artistic eye to get the spy otter to look as lifelike as possible. It's this attention to detail that makes it really come alive. Comes, there are no guarantees it will work. Producer Matthew Gordon and the film crew are about to see whether the hard work has been worth it. A stabilised camera system is also ready to film the otters from afar.
Okay, zoom in.
Zoom in.
That's it. Work with it. It'll be a nice move in.
The images hint at what delightful subjects the otters are going to make.
It was why he was doing his hands like this, okay?
What are you doing?
He's even doing it now. Look, it's wonderful.
Just resting his head on his hands.
Yeah.
Just watching.
It's adorable.
Check's over. It's time to see if Spy Otter can get the intimate footage it came for. As otters are so difficult to approach, the boat must stay a long distance away.
Okay, let's try and get over there.
The colony doesn't seem to. And, of course, the river's inhabitants can be dangerous as well. This spy hippo is submersible and is mainly designed to film underwater shots of the hippos. A second spy hippo has been constructed to film mainly at the surface.
John, can you get on the sticks, please?
Both spy creatures offer close-up views above and below the water. A successful launch, and the submersible spy hippo is soon entering their world. Because penguin cams don't interfere with natural behaviour, they've become a useful device not only for filming, but for scientific research too. Spiadeli came for 2 months to film the penguins stealing stones to build their nests. But he discovered so much more. When a male has his pebbles stolen and fails to impress his mate, she runs off with his love rival. And feathers fly. But perhaps his most useful skill for filming Adelies is his ability to get right back up. Again. And again. When all else fails, Frederick is there to lend a caring hand. This wasn't the only elemental challenge the spies faced. In Kachemak Bay in Alaska, rafts of sea otters regularly congregate just offshore. They are notoriously nervous of people, especially when they have young babies on board. The only way to capture images like this is to create a spy creature that can swim right up to them. The challenge is to somehow create a lifelike replica of one of the most adorable animals on Earth. Back at John Nolan's studio, the basic mechanics are fiendishly complex, but they are just the start. It's Val Jones's job to turn a mechanical and functional robot into something closer to the real thing. This requires meticulously punching synthetic fur into the silicon skin, hair by hair. It takes incredible patience and an artistic eye to get a spy otter to look as lifelike as possible. It's this attention to detail that makes it really come alive. It will be many weeks before it's ready to be deployed among the sea otters of Alaska. But when the day comes, there are no guarantees it will work. Producer Matthew Gordon and the film crew are about to see whether the hard work has been worth it. A stabilised camera system is also ready to film the otters from afar.
Go, zoom in. That's it. Worth it. That'd be a nice move in.
The images hint at what delightful subjects the otters are going to make.
It was the way he was doing his hands like this, okay?
What are you doing?
He's even doing it now, look. It's wonderful.
Just resting his head on his hands.
Yeah.
Just watching.
It's adorable.
Check's over. It's time to see if Spy Otter can get the intimate footage it came for. As otters are so difficult to approach, the boat must stay a long distance away.
Okay, let's try and get over there.
The colony doesn't seem to be alarmed as Spy Otter swims closer.
They sort of pop their head up and they look at it, but they're not scared.
But as Spy Otter moves further from the boat, the controls stop responding. It has reached the limits of good radio reception. Time for a rethink. This time they try a rib. Its lower profile may allow it to get closer to the otters so they can effectively control Spy Otter. Even now, it's uncertain whether the spy creature will be accepted.
Okay, you guys feel free to deploy him when you want, and then you need to pull out.
But it's looking more promising. They are already nearer to an otter than before.
Oh, brilliant.
And Spy Otter boldly swims ever closer.
Okay. Get the head into the right position so that it can film it, doesn't it? Like, yes.
Not it.
This is what we've come to film. Some of the most natural and endearing shots of sea otters ever seen. Spy Otter can even film what's happening underwater. Then, Spy Otter gets a close-up view of their intelligent use of tools. Exactly what the team were hoping to capture. With another success under the team's belt, back in London, more spy creatures are being prepared for their first encounters. Like the sea otter, Spy Prairie Dog is one of many creations made to replicate the animals they are going to film. But sometimes, a different solution is needed. This is Spy Egret. He too is as lifelike as possible. And under the feathers and skin, the metal skeleton is no less impressive. But he's not going to film other birds. His sights are set much higher. He is soon on his first assignment. It's not long before he catches a glimpse of his subjects. Egrets like him follow the elephant herds around, but he's not the only lifelike camera going undercover. Michael Richards is one of the world's most experienced wildlife cameramen and has filmed elephants many times before. He must anticipate the elephant's intentions and deploy remote cameras on a track he thinks they'll take. First out are the plop cams, based on a ball of elephant poo. Then it's the log cams. And finally, a spy tortoise. Now, it's Spy Egret's turn, the most expensive, fragile and irreplaceable of the lot. It's time for quick decisions.
I think they're turning according to us.
Well, they are.
Yeah. It's just popping down here.
Right, okay, swing it. Keep coming, and then you're going to have to reverse. Just so I can hide behind the vehicle. That's great, thank you. Stop there. Stop up. Just so they can't see me.
Okay. The plan is for him to film at the same height as baby elephants, from right inside the herd. With the crew controlling him from a distance, he now has to face the elephants on his own. It's a nerve-wracking moment as he disappears inside a wall of legs. Thanks to some very obliging elephants, the egret survives unscathed. In fact, over the 10 weeks spent with the herd, hardly a feather was ruffled. The same cannot be said for some of the log cams and dung cams. Cameras, you might think, would be less noticeable. They simply appeal to the elephant's playful nature. The spy tortoises fared better, probably because they looked like a living animal. Although there is always one that goes a step too far. Testing one of the spy tortoises to destruction. But the spies are resilient creatures. even when thoroughly pancaked, his cameras kept filming. But hiding in plain sight proved the best plan. All he ever got was mud in his eye. Spy Egret may have survived, but because of the dangerous nature of their subject, others were in mortal danger from the start. Spy crocodile hatchlings were at the sharp end of one of the most deadly animals of them all. They have to be placed in the croc's nest in the brief period she's in the water. Something not for the faint-hearted. They are here to film the crocodile's remarkable maternal instinct. She places her hatchlings in her mouth to carry them to water as a protection against nest-raiding predators. It's not long before Spy Hatchling receives the same extraordinary treatment. And captures a baby croc to view from inside the jaws. It took 8 weeks and 3 trips to the Nile River in Uganda to film the 2 crocodile sequences seen in the series. Here, the team also tested the most ambitious walking spy creature to date. Spy Crocodile has come all the way from a biorobotics lab in Lausanne, Switzerland, where it took 6 months to build. The team, led by producer Rob Pilley, has to find a safe spot to launch the robot near to real crocodile. But it's a wild and dangerous place. Surrounded by animals that can kill you. The river itself can be treacherous.
It's nice and shallow. It's like the crocs love it as well. It's nice. Perfect spot. It'll run aground at any minute.
With hidden sandbanks in the shadows. That was one of them. When they find a sheltered spot, they don't waste any time. Scientists from the lab, Camilo Melo and Tomislav Horvat, are eager to test out their creation. Spy Crocodile is unique, as it is designed to be the first amphibious robot, able to walk on the ground and swim in the water.
If you can make him stand up, please, chaps. That's great.
First tests are on land, but it still requires a radio transmitter and wrist computer to control. Walking seems okay, so it's time to see if all the hard work has paid off.
Walking and a bit more, and swimming.
He's off to a good start, moving with the sinuous motion of a real crocodile. But there's a problem. He's sinking.
I think what's happened is he's got lots of...
Yeah.
It's had a walk.
What?
It's had a walk and a walk.
It's a huge setback for Bob and the team. The inner skin is letting in water.
What do you want to do? Do you want to...
Just cool it down.
Yeah. OK.
This one.
Got any problems?
Yeah.
Wait, I can turn it off maybe. What is it?
They must try it out and